closer properties of context-free languages. Same as in regular languages, here also we have closure properties. So here, first we'll see the basic closure properties of CFL, then some decision properties, then some undecidable problems of CFL, then some applications also. All these topics we'll cover under closure properties of context-free languages. Then coming to one by one, first let us see closure properties of context-free languages. Every property will be denoted by a theorem. So that theorem is also called as the property. So now the first theorem or first property of context-free languages, closure properties. First one is the set of context-free languages are closed under the first one union, the second one concatenation, then the third one star or clean closure. Union is denoted by the set operator union. Concatenation is denoted by using the dot symbol. The star or clean closure is denoted by using the asterisk. So the same statement can be defined more formally as given below. If L1 and L2 are context-free languages, then L1 union L2, this is formal notation, comma L1 dot L2, this is concatenation formal notation. And L1 closure, this is closure notation. L1 or L2, whatever the language you are considering, take its closure. Also denote the context-free languages. And so the CFLs are closed under union, concatenation, and star or clean closure. This is the first theorem or property of context-free languages. Then coming to second theorem or second closure property of context-free languages. The set of context-free languages are not closed under intersection. So intersection is denoted by the set symbol. So the CFLs are not closed under intersection operation. Same statement can be defined more formally as if L1 and L2 are context-free languages, it is not always true that L1 intersection L2 is context-free language. This is more formal representation. That means the context-free languages are not closed under intersection operation. This is the theorem 2 or property 2. Then coming to closure property 3 or theorem 3 of context-free languages. The set of context-free languages are not closed under complementation. Suppose a language is L, its complement is denoted by L dash or L bar. So its complementation is not satisfying by context-free languages. So therefore, the same thing can be denoted as formally. If L is a context-free language, it is not true that the complement of L is context-free language. That means CFLs are not closed under complementation. This is theorem 3 or closure property 3 of context-free languages. Then coming to closure property 4 or theorem 4. The set of context-free languages are closed under substitution. This property satisfied by regular sets or regular languages also, there also. So substitution. In substitution, we have two forms. The one is homomorphism and inverse homomorphism. As we discussed in regular sets or regular languages, same definitions you can use here. So that is theorem 5 or closure property 5. The set of context-free languages are closed under homomorphism and inverse homomorphism. This is the property 5 or theorem 5 of context-free languages. Then coming to theorem 6 or closure property 6 of CFLs. The context-free languages are closed under reversal. So CFL satisfies the reverse condition. So this can be defined more formally. If L is a context-free language, then the reverse is denoted by L power R. So where R is reverse. So the CFLs are closed under reversal. Then property 7 or theorem 7. If L is a context-free language, then R is a regular set or regular language. Here we have taken combination of CFL and regular languages. Then intersection of these two denoted by L intersection R is a contextual language. If you can take a contextual language L and a regular language L, if you can take the intersection of these two, then the result is a contextual language. This is the relationship of a contextual language and regular language. This is the theorem 7 or property 7. Then coming to theorem 8 or property 8, the following are true about a contextual languages L, L1, L2, and a regular language R. Here we have taken three contextual languages and one regular language denoted as R. Then the following conditions satisfying for contextual languages. The first one is L minus R is a contextual language. L is a contextual language, R is a regular language. The subtraction of regular language from contextual language, the result is a contextual language. Then L dash means the complement of L is not necessarily a contextual language, where L dash is complement. Just now we discussed one of the property. The CFLs are not closed under complementation. So according to that property, so L dash is not necessarily a contextual language. Similarly, L1 minus L2, two contextual languages, L1 minus L2 is not necessarily context free. Both contextual languages you can subtract. The result is not necessary a context free. This is the theorem 8 or property 8. So that's all about closure properties of contextual languages. Then other kind of properties of CFL called as decision properties. So a problem is said to be decidable or solvable if there is an algorithm to solve that problem. Otherwise, the problem is said to be undecidable or unsolvable. In regular language also, we discuss this concept. Now, what are the decision properties of contextual languages? The following are some of the decidable problems of contextual languages. Means all are having algorithms to solve. Therefore, all are decidable or solvable problems. The first one is complexity of converting among contextual grammars and PDA. Here we discussed the two conversions, CFG to PDA and PDA to CFG. So for these two conversions, we have algorithm or procedure. So then we already solved these problems. The complexity also, we can easily analyze. So this can be solvable or decidable. The second one, running time of conversion to Chomsky normal form. This also we have procedure. A contextual grammar is reduced to CNF. We have theorem. So theorem is there. According to that theorem, procedure is given. As for the procedure, converting a contextual grammar to CNF by removing all unnecessary unit productions, useless symbols, and null productions, etc. So then during this conversion also, the running time means the complexity is analyzed. This can be solvable or decidable. Then testing emptiness of contextual languages. A contextual language is empty or not. For this also, we have algorithms. So this is also solvable. Then testing membership in a contextual language. This is also solvable, means we have membership algorithm. Now here we will see the membership algorithm for contextual grammars, which is called as, the algorithm name is CYK algorithm. So CYK algorithm is membership algorithm for contextual grammars. The CYK stands for three scientist names starting letters. C stands for cock, Y stands for anger, then K stands for Kasami. So all the three scientist names starting letters are combined and named as CYK. This is called as membership algorithm for contextual grammar. This algorithm can be applied to contextual grammar only whenever the contextual grammar is in Chomsky normal form. Then this algorithm requires mod W power 3 steps to parse a string, means to derive a string, to process a string for the given contextual grammar. Whatever the string, you can take the length mod W, then the length power 3 steps required to parse that string. So now, the CYK algorithm, when it is succeeded, it breaks one problem into sequence of smaller ones. So one problem is divided into smaller ones. Then only it can be succeeded by solving all individual problems. Then final results are combined, like divide and conquer approach in design and analysis of algorithms. Now see how this can be decomposed according to CYK algorithm. So here first we take a grammar, context free grammar, G equal to VTSV, E is in Chomsky normal form. And let us take a string W equal to A1, A2 and so on, AN. Then we define substrings WIJ from A1 to AN as AI, AI plus 1, AI plus 2 and so on, AJ. And subsets of the variables V is denoted by VIJ with the same suffix of the string WIJ. Can be defined as A. A belongs to V such that A derives WIJ. We are taking a variable A from the set V, then A derives the substring WIJ. Then W belongs to L of G. That means the string which is belongs to language generated from the context to grammar. So when this will happen means if and only if the starting variable S belongs to from the set VIJ, the V suffix 1N. That means first variable is designated as starting variable. Then to compute VIJ, observe that A belongs to VIJ if and only if G contains the production. That is A derives terminal A suffix I. So here this is one of the CNF form. Single terminal production, CNF form. So when this derivation will be possible means, so whenever if we have a production A derives terminal AI in G, then only this is possible. Then if you want to compute VIA with same suffix for all I values 1 to N by inspection of W and the productions of the grammar. So this is for one condition of CNF, that is terminal production. Then the second condition, what is the other form of CNF? Two variables length in the right hand side. So for the production A derives BC, here you can see two variables length, where B derives WIK, the first substring, then C derives WK plus 1J, the second substring. So B derives WIK, C derives WK plus 1J, where I less than or equal to K and K less than J. Then by inspection of W, the original string, then the productions of the grammar. So consisting of the following, VIJ equal to union, K belongs to I comma I plus 1 comma and so on, J minus 1, such that the variable A, then A contains BC, that is two variables, length in the right hand side. B belongs to VIK. Then C belongs to VK plus 1, J. So the same strings here, you can say WIK corresponding to VIK, K plus 1, J corresponding to VK plus 1, J. So for the variables B and C. So in this case, by using A derives BC production, the respective substrings are derived. So this is membership algorithm. The two cases are considered. So one is terminal production case, another one, the two variables in the right hand side case. Why? Because these two are the conditions of Chomsky normal form, the two conditions. That is about membership algorithm for context free grammar, which is called as CYK algorithm. Then coming to undecidable context free language problems, there are some undecidable problems also by combination of both context-free grammar and context-free language. So a problem is said to be undecidable or unsolvable means there is no algorithm. A context-free grammar and CFL have no algorithm, then they are called undecidable or unsolvable problems. The most significant undecidable questions about context-free grammars and context-free languages are given below. The first question, what are the given questions? All are undecidable or unsolvable, means no algorithm to solve these questions. Is the given context-free grammar G is ambiguous? So no algorithm to check this one. So undecidable. Then second question, undecidable or unsolvable. Second question, is a given contextual language inherently ambiguous? So by deriving, by derivation, this is also undecidable or unsolvable because there is no algorithm. Is the intersection of two contextual languages, suppose L1, L2, then intersection, L1 intersection L2. So here we can't determine this one. Is empty or not? Then are two CFLs L1 equal to L2? This can't determine, no algorithm to determine. So this is undecidable. Then is given contextual language equal to sigma closure, where sigma is the alphabet. So this is also undecidable. These are only some of the questions or problems which are undecidable related to contextual languages and contextual grammars. Then coming to applications of contextual languages. So contextual languages have great practical importance in defining programming languages is the one. Then in parsing or syntax analysis. This parsing or syntax analysis is nothing but second phase of compiler. There are six phases we have. The first phase, lexical analysis, also called as scanner. So the finite automaton is one of the major concept used in lexical analysis or scanner. Whereas contextual languages is majorly used in the second phase of compiler, which is called as parsing or syntax analysis. Next semester, you have compiler design subject. So there you will study about all these pages. Again, you will review the finite automata, the contextual language, contextual grammar. All topics will be repeated there. So the first application is defining programming languages. Then second one, parsing or syntax analysis, which is the second phase of compiler. And simplifying translation of programming languages. Translation means converting one form to other form, like high level to low level, or high level to machine level, etc. Conversion. Other application, actual programming languages have many features that can be described by means of context-free languages. So actual programming languages have many features. All are described by using context-free languages. These are all the applications of context-free languages. Then coming to summary of this lecture, here first we discussed about various closure properties of context-free languages by using theorems. Total we have 9 properties we discussed. Then later decision properties of context-free languages. Then in decision properties we discussed one of the membership algorithm of context-free grammar. Then we discussed some undecidable problems also related to context-free languages and context-free grammars. Then at last we demonstrated applications of context-free languages. So next class we will come up with other new topics. Now I stop here.